So just a few disclaimers before we begin, to remind you that this isn't a private conversation and will ultimately be made available to the public, as Tracy was just mentioning. We endeavor for this to be an enjoyable experience for you and for me. And if at any point we get into a subject or line of conversation that you're not comfortable with or you don't want to answer, just let me know and we'll redirect. If at any point you need to take a break, just let me know that as well.
Okay.
My role in the conversation today is actually to talk as little as possible. This is to get your life history. But know that I'm fully engaged. I might be looking at my notes occasionally, but am absolutely present.
Okay.
So today is Thursday, March the 22nd, 2018. My name is Andy Reisinger, and I'm interviewing Daniel Blumenthal here in the Department of Special Collections and Archives at Georgia State University as part of the Great Speckled Bird Oral History Project. And before beginning, if I can just get your verbal consent to be recorded.
That would be quite all right.
Fantastic. So let's start at the beginning. If you can tell me a bit of when and where you were born.
I was born in St. Louis, Missouri, on May 26, 1942.
Okay. And what was your family's background? How did they end up in St. Louis? Had they been there a long time?
Well, my grandparents on both sides were immigrants. My father's parents came from what is now Eastern Poland. My mother's parents came from the Alsace-Lorraine area that is sometimes French and sometimes German. Mm-hmm. They spoke German. They migrated to Pleasanton, Kansas, a small town about 50 miles southwest of Kansas City, where they ran a store. My father's parents came to New York through Ellis Island. He mm-hmm. was born in New York, moved to New Jersey when he was a kid, and then he wound up in St. Louis going to medical school. My mom graduated from the University of Kansas and wound up at Barnes Hospital in St. Louis as a med tech, and that's where they met and eventually came to live in St. Louis.
Okay.
So I was born there. My dad was in the Army during World War II and we moved around a lot. Eventually settled in a suburb of St. Louis, white middle class American graffiti kind of suburb, and that's where I lived until I graduated from high school. Went to college in Northern Ohio. I went to med school in Chicago. Should I carry on from there, or would you like to ask some questions along the way?
Yeah. So your father went to med school. Where did he go to medical school at?
Washington University of St. Louis.
And what sort of
was he? He was a pathologist. his love really was research, but he was a clinical pathologist at Jewish Hospital and then a Veterans Hospital in St. Louis, and eventually opened his own commercial laboratory in St. Louis. He was well known to all the practitioners in the city, and so did quite well as the operator, as the owner of a private laboratory that he eventually sold to some big chain company that does laboratory stuff.
And your mother had gone to college?
She went to the University of Kansas.
And studied?
I don't know.
Something that...
But I can tell you she made straight A's, because she reminded me of that quite often. Whatever it was she studied. Somewhere along the line, she learned to do lab work, because that's what she was doing in St. Louis when she met my dad. Mm-hmm. I was often asked when I was a kid if I was going to follow in my father's footsteps and become a physician, and I said, no, absolutely not, anything but that. But he did get me interested in science anyway. My eventual ambition was to become a laboratory scientist, and I was taking laboratory science courses in college. I did a summer research fellowship at the university. I went to college at Oberlin College near Cleveland. Between my junior and senior year, did a research fellowship at the University of Michigan, where I studied under the supervision, the loose supervision of an ophthalmologist who had me doing research on frogs' eyes. The idea was to shine different colored lights in the frog's eyes and then take photos to see how the pupil, the frog's pupils reacted to the different color and intensity of light. In order to do this, I was supposed to pith the frog. Pithing the frog means you drive a probe through the spinal cord just behind the head, so frog is paralyzed from the neck down. Mm-hmm. Not sure frogs have necks, but you get the idea. And this is not anything that I could bring myself to do. So I spent half the summer figuring out a way to hogtie the frog so that it couldn't hop away.
Right.
And the rest of the summer, taking photos of his eyes, as I say, under loose supervision. So when I got to the end of the summer, I showed my product to the supervisor, who said, quote, "Well, this isn't really what I had in mind." So that was a little discouraging. And at that point, I decided maybe being a research scientist, really, or at least a laboratory scientist, really wasn't what I wanted to do. Maybe I ought to go to med school after all.
Mm-hmm.
So it was not hard to change my course, since I'd been taking all the pre-med courses anyway. And so I just changed my post-college applications and went to med school at the University of Chicago.
Mm-hmm. Before we get there, can you identify your parents by name?
Why?
Just for a sort of genealogy of where you come from.
Yeah, well, they're not alive, so I guess it's harmless. My mother's name was Eleanor, her maiden name was Gottlieb, and my dad's name was Herman.
Okay. And in what year did they get married? Thereabouts?
I'll say 1940.
Okay. And do you have any siblings?
Yeah. I have a brother in my generation. He's 4 years younger than I am. And my dad had two families. My mom died in the 70s, in the 1970s. And a few years later, my dad remarried a woman who was about 35 years younger than he was, and they had two children. So I have a half brother and a half sister who are 30 some odd years younger than I am, and they each have two children. My half sister has a pair of twins who are 6 years old, and brother who lives in Paris, he's married to a French woman, and they have daughters age 7 and 9.
Okay. And so you described that you grew up in the suburbs, in a sort of American graffiti-esque sort of environment. Can you describe your schooling and life as a young person, your interests, hobbies, what you did for fun?
Yeah. So I was the only Jewish kid in a all Gentile community. My family was probably almost the only Democrats in a suburb of Republicans. But I was pretty apolitical in those days. Very much into sports, I guess, and girls, and was doing teenage stuff. I played the piano some. I was in a rock and roll band when I was in high school. We played for junior high school dances and parties and things like that. Had a good time with that. So I guess it was, you know, Archie and Jughead, typical teenager life as a high school student. I was even probably more into sports when I was in college, which is sort of interesting because I went to a very political college, Oberlin, where sports are not a prominent part of the landscape. But I was, a friend and I were the play-by-play announcers on the college radio stations for football and basketball games. So we literally went to all the games, home and away. I was the sports editor on the newspaper, the college newspaper, for a time. Something I would only have the opportunity to do at a small college because a big university, it's all professionals who do that sort of work. So it was only later, I guess, toward the end of my college career that I began thinking about political things, which I guess would eventually bring me to the underground newspaper world.
Had you had any prior experience in grade school, high school, with journalism, working on a student paper, or?
Yeah, actually that was, as a high school student and when I was getting ready to go to college, that was kind of the choice I had to make between journalism and science. I guess I could have gone into science journalism, but that didn't occur to me. But I worked on the junior high school paper and on the high school paper, and I was a feature editor and I wrote a humor column. And then, as I mentioned, I worked on my college paper as a sports editor. The summer that I spent in Michigan, I was worked as a reporter on the Michigan Daily. I've always been into journalism, and even now I read the local newspaper and criticize the way they're writing headlines and that kind of thing. So I still highly value my little journalism background as a high school, college journalist.
And were there any people in your life as a young person that were particularly influential, or any events that made a major impact on you?
Well, as I've indicated, when I was in, grade school and high school, my dad had an influence on me, kind of orienting me to science. And he brought home science stuff from his lab so I could do chemistry experiments in the basement and that kind of thing. I was an amateur herpetologist, and I used to go out in the woods and catch snakes and keep them in cages in my basement, and my mom was quite tolerant of that. Although one of them got out once, and she was not very tolerant of that. I had a sort of a mentor who was a faculty member at St. Louis University and a friend of my dad, who was a field biologist and would take me out on field trips, and we'd look for blind cave salamanders and rare minnows or something in creeks. An experience that I really valued. I really enjoyed doing that kind of thing. And so when I was trying to decide where to go to college, he had a major influence on me when he advised me that a good small college was better than a good big university. And I was actually at the time trying to choose between Oberlin and the University of Michigan, if you can imagine that I was at those. That those are the last two schools on my list. And so I think it was really his influence that made me choose Oberlin rather than U of M. So those are, if I think about who had influence on my life at that stage in my life, it was probably my dad and Joe Gorman, who was the other guy. Mm-hmm.
And so you graduate high school in what year?
1960.
Okay, and then go straight off to Oberlin.
Went straight to college, and after college I went straight to medical school. Which may sound a little odd to young people these days, I don't know, because it seems that the route that I took, which is, you know, high school, college, med school, internship, I mean, just without a gap year, mm-hmm. without taking off to do something else, seemed a little peculiar. But that's what I did. I mean, that was more the norm in those days, I think.
And did you enter Oberlin at majoring in one of the sciences?
Well, you declare your major after your sophomore year, but yeah, okay. I was a zoology major because that's, you know, the direction I was headed at the time. Mm-hmm. I didn't become formally a pre-med until really my senior year in college. But as I say, it was all the same courses, so it wasn't really a change.
And you earlier had described Oberlin as being a more political college. How did that manifest itself in your years there, or how did you become aware to make that sort of characterization?
Well, it was people writing in the college paper, it was the speakers that were brought onto campus, it was the discussions that were held in the dorms. But as I indicated, I was more into sports than I was into politics. I think that in our conversation here, you and I, we will eventually get into the war in Vietnam, which was just starting to heat up about that time, and which I often say determined the whole rest of my life. But that was when I sort of started to become political, because I became aware of the war and what we were doing in Southeast Asia and how it seemed to me at the time, and still, that we were in the business of supporting one corrupt dictator over a different corrupt dictator and killing hundreds of thousands of people in the process of doing that. And I thought that was awful and decided I wasn't going to be part of it. And so the story goes on from there. I don't know. You may want to ask me questions about that.
Yeah, no, please do tell me more about that, when, how so, your consciousness was raised.
So I was in college, and the draft was already underway at that time, but I had deferments to be a college student. And then when I was in med school, the war was even more a part of the public consciousness, and I had deferments. And through all of these 8 years, I said, well, surely this war is going to be over by the time cease to be a student and run out of student deferments, but in fact it was not. So let me organize my thoughts here for a mm-hmm. second, because mm-hmm. I say this is what determined though. So I'll just kind of condense it here. I was reclassified. So after I graduated from medical school, I entered an internship in New Orleans, Charity Hospital of New Orleans, on the two-lane service.
And this is in 68?
This would have been, right, in 68 and 69. And it was reclassified 1A, which meant that I was a prime draft candidate. So I applied for conscientious objector status. My draft board, which was located in suburban St. Louis, had recently awarded conscientious objector status to a Roman Catholic, and the Selective Service Board, the Selective Service Agency, had appealed that ruling the appeals mechanism for the Selective Service was in place for people who had been drafted or who were dissatisfied with their classification so that they could appeal it. This was the first time it had ever been used by the Selective Service to appeal a classification. And the appeals board overruled my local draft board and denied the applicant's conscientious objector status. So they had had their wrist slapped, really, by Selective Service, and had pretty much determined that they were not awarding conscientious objector status to anybody except board-certified Quakers and Jehovah's Witnesses. So I didn't qualify in that regard. But there was a series of appeals and hearings and things that I could go through. And so I did all of that through my year of internship, and of course was denied at each appeal and at each hearing. So then it became close to the end of my internship here, and it was clear that I was going to be drafted if I didn't do so. And I was prepared to move to Canada if I needed to do that. I don't want to do that. I don't like cold weather. Mm-hmm. So my wife and I decided that we would join VISTA, Volunteers in Service to America. I have come to realize that most people these days don't know what VISTA is. It still does exist. It's now part of AmeriCorps. At that time, it was called the Domestic Peace Corps. Informally, it was known as the Domestic Peace Corps. We considered joining the Peace Corps, which would be a two-year commitment, and I was not inclined to go that direction because I knew that I would be sent to some place where the resources didn't really exist to address the huge problems that existed in developing countries. I thought that VISTA might be a better choice because, first of all, it was only a one-year commitment, and secondly, it was in the richest country on earth where we do have the resources to address the problems, even though we don't choose to use them that way. So we did join VISTA, and I was assigned to Lee County, Arkansas. This is a rural county in the Mississippi River Delta in eastern Arkansas. Its county seat is Marianna. It's about 80 miles southwest of Memphis, Tennessee. Lee County had a population of 18,000. Marianna, a population of 6,000. It was the only population center with more than 300 people in the county. There were three paved roads in the county, a north-south road, an east-west road, and one that was kind of northwest, southeast direction. Everything else was dirt or gravel. It was said to be the seventh poorest county in the country. The population was 60% black, 70% poor, and it was an old South segregated white power structure rural county. So there were separate schools. I remember this was 1969, 1970. Brown versus Board of Education was 1954. Segregated movie theater. White people went in the front door, black people went in the back door and up to the balcony. And segregated water fountains. It was a white county judge who sort of ran the county with the assistance of the white sheriff. So this project that I was assigned to was part of a larger project called VISTA Health Advocates. I think there were 25 VISTA volunteers who were being assigned to maybe six counties in the along the Mississippi River. And so we went through a period of VISTA training. There were going to be, I think, maybe six VISTA volunteers assigned to Lee County. So this all started in July, and it was not long after that, a couple of weeks into VISTA, that I got my induction notice. I was supposed to report to Fort Sam Houston on September 6th, I believe it was, 1969. So my view was that I was preparing to serve my country. I was going to be the lowest paid practicing physician in the country, working in the 7th poorest county in the country, providing services to people who desperately needed them. And the U.S. government was proposing to take me away from that and send me to this war that I refused to participate in, despite the fact that my draft board had actually met their quota of physicians for the year, and were just doing this out of spite. So those who are old enough to remember will remember that the head of the Selective Service Bureau agency at the time was General Louis Hershey, and the other 20-some-odd VISTA volunteers on this project all wrote letters to General Hershey. And the VISTA people said they knew some people with political influence, and they would mobilize them. And then I wrote to my two senators from Missouri, Stuart Symington and Thomas Eagleton. One of the two senators from Arkansas, William Fulbright. The congressman from the district where I was going in Arkansas. My congressman from the St. Louis area, who was Symington Jr. Governor of Arkansas, who was Winthrop Rockefeller. And just for the heck of it, George McGovern. And as far as I can tell, all these people contacted General Hershey, or most of them, or a lot of them, and General Hershey let me out. And what he did was require my draft board to reconsider my case. And while my draft board was reconsidering my case, I got into the U.S. Public Health Service. U.S. Public Health Service counted as military time, so I had 2 years to spend in the U.S. Public Health Service.
And is that something you had to apply to? And
it was something I had to apply to. I had actually applied to it previously. The U.S. Public Health Service, among other things, provides medical care in federal prisons and on Indian reservations. I imagined myself going to an Indian reservation someplace, but it was hugely competitive at the time because it counted as military time. And so I didn't get into the Public Health Service the first time, but I reapplied and I got in the second time. And I got in by applying to something called the Epidemic Intelligence Service, which is at the Centers for Disease Control here in Atlanta. And that is how I happened to come to Atlanta, and I've been in Atlanta ever since, which is one of the reasons I say the war in Vietnam determined the whole rest of my life.
Yeah.
So I guess that's sort of the short form story of my experience with my draft board and what brought me to Atlanta. We can...
Yeah, let's go back and flesh out some things that you had mentioned. You mentioned that upon graduating from, well, I guess I'll start chronologically.
All right.
You mentioned moving to rural Arkansas to work for VISTA and just how segregated it was and all the racial politics that come along with that. What had been your experience with race relations, knowledge of what was going on in terms of racial politics in the country at this time, from your growing up in St. Louis, and you spent a year in New Orleans, had been in Michigan, so you had been in several locales that probably had different environments.
When I was in med school, between my junior and senior year in med school, I was involved in a summer project on the south side of Chicago, a community called Englewood. Which involved working with an organization, a local community organization. I did community organizing, and I learned about community organizing, and I learned about what it was like to live in a low-income African-American urban community. And then after that summer...
And what was that project? Or sort of the thrust of the organizing?
So it was an interdisciplinary project. I was part of a team that consisted of myself, a dental student from Loyola, and two high school students. And you know, we sort of were plopped down there to figure out something to do, and what we wound up doing was an inventory of health services and creating a manual that could be distributed so that people could figure out where to go for health care or for other social services that they might need. It was a project, I would say, of rather modest usefulness, perhaps a bit of usefulness, to the organization that I was working with, and perhaps more useful to me as an educational experience. Back at school in the fall, I got a phone call one day from Captain Velasquez. He was a captain in the Salvation Army. Salvation Army had a headquarters building in Englewood, and the building had been constructed with a clinic facility, but the clinic facility had never been used. The clinic facility, I mean, there were exam rooms and a waiting area, all the kinds of rooms that you expect to see when you go to a doctor's office or a clinic. So he asked me if I could organize something there, could create some kind of a clinical operation. So in fact, I got together with some other medical students and some other dental students from Loyola, and we got some faculty to supervise us, and we created Chicago's first free clinic there in Englewood, the Community Health Center of Englewood. And that continued to operate for at least a few years after I graduated from medical school. So that was my first experience with that summer, and then the rest of my senior year was my first experience in that kind of environment, which when I got to thinking about ways that I could get out of the draft, made working for Vista, where I understood that I would be working again in that kind of environment, seemed like a comfortable thing to do. And in fact, when my wife and I applied to Vista and it said on the application form, where would you like to go? We said, any large city. And then they sent us to Lee County.
And growing up in the suburbs of St. Louis, you had to describe it earlier as very white, middle class. Mm-hmm. Was it completely white?
Yes. It was, so I graduated in 1960, so school, when did you say Brown versus Board of Education was, 54?
That's when it was decided, but in the ruling, the institution of it was with all deliberate speed.
Yeah,
so.
Right, but the school system that I was in did integrate right after that decision, so that would have been 55 or 50, mm-hmm. some 55, 56, something like that, at which time I was in junior high school, mm-hmm. I guess. In that suburb there was a community my suburb was Kirkwood, and there was a community called Meacham Park, and I'm not sure if that was actually within the Kirkwood city limits or not, but they had their own high school and their own grade school, and so integration came from that. And so when I was in junior high, that was my first encounter with black classmates, because there hadn't been any before then. My brother tells this story, because he was in grade school, I guess, when I was in junior high school. We went to the same grade school, and the custodians, as they were known, of that school were a married couple, African Americans, named Grady and Viola Woods. Grady was the only adult male in the school. The teachers and the principal were all women, and they were the only two black people in the school. And all the teachers were Mrs. Harris, Mrs. Lane, Mrs. Smith, and the two custodians were to the kids, Grady and Viola. They called them Grady and Viola. Hi, Grady. Until Brown versus Board of Education. And then by, I guess, order of the principal, they became Mr. and Mrs. Woods. And I thought that was interesting. Mm-hmm. So there's that little story.
And at Oberlin, was there much racial integration while you were there?
There are a rather small number of African-American students, but you know, Oberlin has this history. Oberlin was the first white college in the United States to admit black students, and the first men's college to admit women. And it was a stop on the Underground Railroad. So it has this history that is very, very important to the college. And I've got to say, even when I go back there today, I would sort of like to see more African-American students on campus. Might have something to do with the fact that it's quite an expensive place to go to school. So I would have to say that I didn't encounter any overt racism that I can think of when I was there as opposed to my experience as a med student at the University of Chicago, where I heard some pretty awful racist jokes, or my experience as an intern and resident in New Orleans, ditto. But I can't remember anything during my college years, which would be appropriate. Although, actually, in the last couple of years, there have been some really unfortunate incidents at Oberlin of people painting racial epithets on walls and that kind of thing, which I think is, I mean, I don't even know if they were students at the college. It could have been somebody else who did that. I don't think they ever caught the people who did it. But it made newspaper headlines anyway, I think because of the history of the school. And you know, you have this school that actually really played a role in fighting racism in its worst forms in the United States. And then these racial incidents pop up, so gets in the newspaper. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did I throw us off the beaten path?
No, not at all. And on that subject of politics on campus, at both Oberlin and Chicago, were you aware of much organizing around racial equality as well as anti-war activism?
Well, the anti-war stuff was going on for sure. But you know, the interestingly, the political stuff at the University of Chicago that I was aware of was student politics. I mean, there was a student government and people ran for office. And the medical school was entitled to two representatives in the student senate, and nobody in the medical school gave a hoot about the student senate. But I mean, there were like campus political parties, and one of these parties came to one of my apartment mates and me and said, you know, we'd like to get a couple more representatives in the student senate. Would you guys consider running for the student senate? And we said, yeah, it sounds like fun. So we did, and we got elected to the student senate, and I spent a year or two as a student senator. And if you ask me what issues we debated, I have no memory of that. But it was, I don't know, it was, but I was a student senator. I ought to put that on my CV. I don't think I did.
Yeah. You also mentioned as you were applying to Vista, that you were doing so with your wife.
Right.
Can you fill us in on the backstory of when you met your wife, what she was doing at the time? It sounded like she also applied to Vista.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, I think that was a requirement. If you married, you both had to go in. Mm-hmm. Even if it wasn't a requirement, I mean, it's certainly what we would have done. No, we met, she was a graduate student at the U of C, and I was a medical student, and we met at a party, pretty standard stuff.
What was she studying?
She was studying developmental psychology. So when we were assigned to this health-related project, there's a lot of story to be told about that project, but I was a physician, she was a developmental psychologist, although she didn't have her degree yet. We had a nurse, and then in training, one of the Vista volunteers got some training in housing and sanitation, and another one in nutrition. I mean, so we had a group of sort of specialists in these various areas that could contribute to the health services aspect of the project. I should mention that that woman, my first wife, died in 1994, and I remarried later. And so later on in this story, when I refer to my wife, it'll be a different mm-hmm. wife.
And what is your first wife's name?
Janet.
Janet. And so there were a team of you all that went to Arkansas, like half a dozen maybe? Or?
So there are, I think, about a half a dozen in Lee County. And then there were others scattered up and down the 100-mile stretch or so of the Mississippi River Delta from the Missouri border down to, I think Lee County was the southernmost of the counties that the project was directed at. Right, so having had this narrow brush with the draft, we sort of settled in there in Lee County without having any real idea of what to do. You have to realize that I was the only physician in Vista. At that time, I was the only physician who had ever been in Vista. I didn't really know what to do with me. So, but they did have this health advocates project. So they said, "Oh, you're a doctor. You sign into the health advocates project." And then they said, "Go do something." And Vista at that time was really built around community organizing. And we had community organizing training, and I had some background in that from my experience in Chicago. And so in Lee County, we organized four neighborhood action councils, one in Marianna and one in three of the little settlements outside of Marianna, one in each of three. And these were places where people could get together and think about what the issues were and how they were going to address them. And so I and the other Vistas attended these Neighborhood Action Council meetings, and I said, "What kind of help can we be? What can we do to help you out here?" And they said, "We need a place to go when we get sick," is basically what they said. Now, I had imagined that I'd be involved in some kind of a public health project, intestinal worm control, for instance, which was a major problem in the county, or I don't know, health education or something, but they said we need a place to go when we're sick, and that made sense. So there were four physicians in the county at the time. One of them was in his 80s, should have retired long before. One of them was generally known to be incompetent. One of them was the most liberal of the four was a woman who was raising a family and was sort of in halftime practice. And the fourth was an officer in the John Birch Society. I don't know if the John Birch Society still exists, but it was the extreme right organization at the time. He had segregated waiting rooms. I think the others did not, but I'm not sure. But I can't remember that, but I do remember Dr. Dwight Gray and his segregated waiting rooms, because we talked about that. I mean, when I got there, I went around and visited each of these physicians along with a number of other people. And I remember him telling me that he had had a visit from somebody from Pennsylvania who didn't understand why he had segregated waiting rooms. And Dr. Gray said, well, he just didn't understand. And so that sort of contributed to my understanding of the perspective of the segregationists in the segregated South. So what we decided we needed to do was create a clinic of some kind. But in the meantime, I needed to be able to see some people who needed medical care. And I had received a suggestion during a visit I paid to a guy, I think his name was Donald Pinkle. He was the director of St. Jude's Children's Hospital in Memphis. And he said, why don't you just make house calls? And I said, well, that's a good idea. Now, I couldn't just sort of hang out a shingle and say available for house calls, because the demand would have been more than I could deal with. So I became a house call physician by referral. So if I was referred by a patient, by a school teacher, or somebody in the welfare office or something like that, then I'd get a list and I'd make house calls. Making house calls is absolutely the best way to practice medicine. You get somebody's house and you see where they live and you meet their family and you understand what made them sick and what keeps them sick and what you can do to address that other than writing a prescription for some pills, or what you can't do to address that, or whose help you need to. But it's not very efficient. So I could see maybe a half a dozen patients in a day by driving around in my car. And another issue was the fact, as I mentioned before, there were a limited number of paved roads in the county. And when it rained, the dirt roads turned to mud. And I got stuck in the mud a number of times. I had a Ford Mustang that I was driving. It was not built to drive down muddy country roads. So got to the point where I would say, I will drive as far as where your dirt road meets the paved highway and park my car there, and you come meet me in your pickup truck and take me to your house. So that worked out pretty well. But we're going to come back to the muddy roads in a minute here. The Vista volunteers, who were viewed as do-gooders when we first got to the county, when we started doing community organizing, and as one of the doctors said, going to black churches and encouraging people to stand up for their rights, we became sort of persona non grata. And at one point, we were persona non grata enough so that the town church people organized a religious service Sunday to honor the doctors of Mariana, except I wasn't invited, just the other four. So there was that, and then there was the issue with the hospital. There was a 25-bed hospital in Mariana, the Lee Memorial Hospital, and I applied for admitting privileges there. So to get admitting privileges there, you had to be a member of the County Medical Society. The County Medical Society consisted of the four doctors. And I was denied membership in the medical society by a vote of 3-1. The lady voted for me. The other three said that because I was a government employee and so practicing socialized medicine, and they were opposed to that. And this got in the newspaper. I forget exactly how this happened, but somebody tipped off the governor's secretary or something like that. The governor knew who I was, actually, by the way, when I got out of the draft. The governor called me up to tell me that he'd gotten me out of the draft. So this got back to the governor and the governor's secretary, and it got in the newspaper, and as things heated up, you know, with the religious service and the hospital and some other issues, I was in the paper frequently, and then CBS heard about it, and so a crew came down, and they called me up and said that they were going to do a story, and I said, I don't know if I want to participate in that. And they said, well, we're going to do the story anyway, whether you participate in it or not. So I said, well, I guess I might as well participate. So I was on television and national television, and they followed me around making a house call. Then I got stuck in the mud, and the camera crew had to push me out, and so my car stuck in the mud was on national television, and people were saying, you drove into that mud hole on purpose, didn't you, just to give us a bad picture on TV. And to say nothing in the world would persuade me to drive into a mud hole on purpose. I didn't mean to do that. So my 15 minutes of fame went on for about 6 months. Well, I was in Lee County. There was a second TV show, and chapters in various books and a lot of newspaper stories. I'm getting out of sequence here, but remember, this all started because we were trying to get a clinic started. So we got a little grant from a federal agency called the Emergency Food and Medical Services. Yes, it's just called Emergency Food and Medical Services. I think it was $35,000. I mean, that wouldn't do anything these days, even when you consider, you know, inflation, but. But the Vista volunteers were on the federal payroll, so we had enough money from that to hire 4 community health workers and to rent a building, but nobody would rent us a building, including the Missouri Pacific Railroad, which had an abandoned railroad depot there in the town that we tried to rent, and they said it wasn't for rent. Sorry, guys. But the black funeral director finally did rent us a house that he owned that was next to his funeral parlor, so we were able to start his medical clinic next door to the funeral parlor. And there was a flower shop on the other side, and this irony was not lost on everybody. So we did have that going, and so let me back up to say that remember the free clinic in Chicago?
Mm-hmm.
We had an advisory board that consisted of people who worked for the health department and practicing physicians in town because we thought we needed an advisory board. But once I was in Vista and had my horizons expanded, I realized that this was not the kind of advisory board you need because none of those people would ever be patients at this free clinic. So this time I did it the right way. We did it the right way, I thought. And we called this facility the Lee County Cooperative Clinic. And we organized it as a cooperative. And it had a board of directors that consisted of 2 people elected from each of the 4 neighborhood action councils. So they were really patients or potential patients who were the owners in the real sense of this clinic. And actually, jumping ahead, the clinic is still there. It's now a federally funded community health center. Mm-hmm. And a couple of years ago, the federal agency that funds it, the Health Resources and Services Administration, came down and said, this governance structure that you have is real 1970s. But we don't do things that way anymore. Now you've got to have a board of directors that consists of businessmen and prominent citizens and politicians. So it's still called the Lee County Cooperative Clinic, but it's really no longer a cooperative. Anyway, so we had this all consumer patient board of directors. And then we met a guy named Ollie Neal, who was a dynamic, articulate, charismatic guy who was from Lee County. And at the time was working for St. Jude's Hospital in Memphis in a supplemental feeding program. And I think he heard about us from one of these TV shows and got in contact, and he said, and we needed an administrator for this clinic. And so we signed up Ollie, who had no experience with that sort of thing, but it was a pretty small operation, you know, $35,000. And four paid people, the rest of us being paid by the feds. But we had this community organization mentality, and we had this community organization, this set of community organizations, and then Ollie was this dynamic guy. And before too long, there was a spin-off organization called Concerned Citizens of Lee County, which was the political organization, and ran some folks for public office, the first black candidates in Lee County since Reconstruction. And I think two of them were elected justices of the peace. Nobody was elected county judge. I have to say that voter registration is not yet strong in the county. It seemed that there were some irregularities at the polls, but at least Ollie said he didn't think it really made any difference in the outcome of the election. So I was there for 1 year because the program that I had gotten into with the Public Health Service was a program under which I was supposed to go back, and remember, I'd just done an internship. I was supposed to go back and do my residency and then go to CDC. So after I left, we actually recruited another physician as a VISTA volunteer to follow me, and then he recruited a couple people to follow him. And things got sort of out of control, and there was a boycott of the downtown Marianna businesses from people demanding economic justice, you know, hiring African-American workers and that sort of thing. And the boycott drove probably a third of the businesses in Lee County out of business.
And what was that in the same year that you were there,
This was a year or two later. Okay. Yeah, it was probably 2 years later when this boycott happened, and there was a school boycott around educational issues. Mm-hmm. So you can imagine the schools became integrated probably a year after I was there. And then almost immediately became resegregated. There was a private school called Lee Academy. It was established where all the white kids went. And there were still a few whites who couldn't afford to go there. Left. And it was mostly black public schools. But there was a school boycott, and there were shots fired, and there were buildings burned. Somehow nobody got hurt, but it was pretty tense for quite a while. Eventually, the hospital went out of business, as virtually all rural hospitals of that size that's happened. The county has become largely depopulated. I mean, it's gone from 18,000 to maybe 12,000 now. Poverty rate has dropped from 70% to maybe 35%. There was one industry there that made automobile seat covers that closed. So I'm not sure how the poverty rate managed to go. I guess because so many poor people moved away is what drove the poverty rate down. But as I mentioned, the clinic is still there. They built a couple of years after I left, they built a new building. So they've got, it's no longer in this house, but it's in an actual clinic building. But that clinic building was built in 1972, maybe, something like that. And they're still using the same building, and it hasn't, you know, been, it's a little down at the heels now. I mean, I've been back a few times. But it is an example of people organizing around a health issue that morphed into political action, that morphed into some improvement in living conditions that are demonstrable, poverty rates down. Things are, you know, the clinic is now a member of the Chamber of Commerce. So it's hard to say in any kind of a scientific way what the role was of the Vista Project and the clinic in all of this. I have done some comparisons of current health status in Lee County as compared to adjoining counties, and Lee County is a bit ahead of the others, so that suggests something good about the community organization efforts that went on there. But, you know, so it's sort of like when you say Columbus discovered America. It's not like if Columbus had never existed, America never would have been discovered. Somebody else would have discovered it. So if none of this had taken place in Lee County, it still would have eventually gotten integrated. Living conditions still would have improved some, I think. So, you know, as I say, it's not a controlled experiment. It's hard to say exactly what the cause and effect was, but I think what we did there played a role, and maybe that's still reflected in health status indices that are a bit better in Lee County than in adjoining counties.
Mm-hmm. On the point of this health center and setting it up as a cooperative, do you recall how you were aware that was even an option to set something up as a cooperative? Had you had experience with other co-ops?
So in those days, we had 6 weeks of VISTA training, and we learned about community organizing. We learned about co-ops, and we learned about a lot of stuff that I didn't really know about until then. So, I mean, they turned us into a bunch of rabble-rousers. They don't do that anymore. Mm-hmm. And every now and then, I'm asked to speak to a group of VISTA volunteers or some other group of young people, and I say, see what you can do to change the world. You know, I'm afraid that VISTA's and the rest of AmeriCorps is to some extent kind of directed into do-gooder stuff without a political angle to it. And, just saying politics is sort of a bad word these days, but in fact, life is political, and it has been said that politics are just medicine on a larger scale. And there's some truth to that, that if you're going to make any progress, it takes on a political aspect. Mm-hmm. And so I think that the fact that at one time, as part of Lyndon Johnson's Great Society, we had a large cohort of young people who were trying to actually make social change was really a good thing, and it is a better thing than just doing charity work. Mm-hmm. What else can I tell you? Shall we carry on with my life post-VISTA?
Almost, but I did want to follow up. So, was Janet also working at the clinic? Or did she have a different role?
So, I would have to say that everybody was working at the clinic to some extent, but the clinic went beyond the walls of the clinic. And I mentioned community health workers, and actually the reason we had community health workers was to keep people out of the clinic. I mean, this was a busy place, I gotta tell you. I was seeing 30 patients a day. It was free. We had a box out in the waiting room that said, if you can afford to, please put some money in the box. And some people did. But there were people out doing housing projects, nutrition projects, teaching classes. As I mentioned, my wife was a developmental psychologist, so she was doing that kind of early child development work.
Like, was that in the schools that she would do that, or on a...
It was on a case-by-case basis, actually. But she was also doing some nutrition counseling and, you know, this and that, and helping out with the organizing part, because a lot of that's just knocking on doors and telling people about the meeting and getting them there. And so there was a lot of that kind of work to be done. Mm-hmm. I mean, once the doors of the clinic opened, then it was, I was sort of on site for the, except still making some house calls, you know, so I worked there, and then somebody really needed a house call because they had no transportation or they couldn't get out of bed or something, then I'd go up to their house. But the others were still engaged in community organizing. Mm-hmm.
And so you were only there for a year and then joined the Public Health Service.
Right.
And was Janet able to come with you, or because wasn't it a two-year...
No, it was a one-year...
Oh, it was a one-year...
Vista's a one-year gig.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's right.
And AmeriCorps currently.
Okay.
You can re-up for another year,
mm-hmm.
But I didn't have that option.
And so you all... Did you debark directly from Arkansas and come to Atlanta, or...?
No, from Arkansas back to New Orleans, because remember, I still had to do my residency.
Oh, that's right.
So okay. So it's a little, it was a little different then than now. An internship was a kind of a freestanding year, and then you did a residency afterwards.
Okay.
So my residency was in pediatrics. These days, if you want to do a pediatric residency, you apply while you're in medical school. There's a match where you get hooked up with a particular residency program. And that's a three-year thing. But in those days, there was internship, and while you were an intern, you applied to be a resident. And in fact, I did, not knowing what kind of a doctor I wanted to be, I did what was called a rotating internship, which meant 2 months of pediatrics, 3 months of medicine, 2 months of surgery, a month of OBGYN, and so forth, to fill out the 12 months. And it was during that internship year when I acquired a mentor who was the chair of the Department of Pediatrics, who said to me, if you go into internal medicine, which is what I was thinking of doing at the time, he says, if you go into internal medicine, you're going to spend most of your time taking care of old people and trying to keep them alive for a few more years. But in pediatrics, you're taking care of young people who have their whole lives ahead of them, and you can really make a difference in their life. And that was really what sold me on going into pediatrics. So I went back and did a pediatric residency. So again, ped's residency now is a three-year residency. At that time, it was you do an internship and then you do a two-year residency. And you could do a straight pediatric internship, I think this is right, but you still had to do a two-year residency. But I had done this rotating internship, I still did 2 years of peds, and then I became board eligible in pediatrics.
Okay.
So I went back to New Orleans for 2 years, and then I came to Atlanta.
And where were you at? What hospital were you based at in New Orleans?
Charity Hospital in New Orleans, big public hospital. In fact, when I was in med school, I was at the University of Chicago, which was this, you know, elite private institution. So I said, what I really want to go for my graduate training is a big public hospital. And so that's when I went to Charity. And somewhere along the lines, I'd gotten interested in tropical diseases, and Tulane's got a school of public health and tropical medicine, and I thought maybe I'd get to see some tropical medicine there. In fact, I did not, but anyway, that was part of the decision-making process. Mm-hmm. So I was back in New Orleans for 2 years, and then came to Atlanta. In New Orleans, I was the chair of the Medical Committee for Human Rights. Medical Committee for Human Rights was an organization that was really organized around civil rights, and provided medical assistance, medical backup for the kids who came south during Freedom Summer in 64, and then were involved in projects ranging from free clinics to occupational health to anti-war activities to various civil rights activities. And they had chapters around the country, and there was a chapter in New Orleans. And when I went back to New Orleans, I sort of fell into the role of chair of the New Orleans chapter of Medical Committee for Human Rights, and we did various projects and brought in speakers and had a whole portfolio of progressive stuff that we did.
And were you already sort of tapped into a community, a network of friends, people, when you came back for your residency? Or how did you become acquainted with the organization or the people?
We had a couple of friends there. This was a long time ago. And we already had some friends there. I think we moved there. It seems to me that it was mostly new friends that we made after we got back to New Orleans.
And where were you living in New Orleans?
We lived in the French Quarter. Actually, my internship year and then the 2 years when we were back there, we lived in the French Quarter. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It gave us a firsthand close-up view of Mardi Gras.
Mm-hmm.
I have to tell you, the one Mardi Gras is probably enough for anybody. The second year I sort of tolerated it, and the third year I was ready to do what most of the locals do during Mardi Gras, which is leave town. But then I had friends, it seemed like, from all over the country that wanted to come stay with us at Mardi Gras, so we stayed in town. I have not been back for Mardi Gras because I had enough Mardi Gras. Mm-hmm.
And before we started the interview and we're just chatting, you mentioned the two underground newspapers in New Orleans.
There were two underground newspapers in New Orleans, one called the Ungarbled Word, or just The Word, as we called it. The Ungarbled was in smaller type, Garbled Word. And the other was NOLA Express. NOLA is New Orleans, Louisiana.
Mm-hmm.
The Word was more of a hippie paper, entertainment focused, that sort of thing. The editor was a guy named Roger Lovin, who walked around the editorial office naked, and everybody sort of had a good time. NOLA Express was more of a serious kind of political paper. Bob Head and Darlene Fife were the editors. Serious left-wing people. I had a column called Through a Stethoscope Darkly that I think started out in The Word and at some point moved over to NOLA Express. Maybe The Word went out of business. I can't remember, but I know that at one time or another I wrote for both of the underground papers. And the column was really a political column about health politics.
Mm-hmm.
And at least once I know the column that I had written didn't get published because it was just too wonky. I mean, nobody outside of healthcare would have cared about the stuff that I was writing about. So it didn't get, but most of the time I was able to relate it to things that people were familiar with and cared about.
Like, what would be some examples of subjects you were writing on?
So the topic at the time was, there was a guy at Tulane named Joe Beasley who had acquired a lot of federal money to open a lot of family planning clinics and was doing some stuff with the money that was not entirely what the money was intended for. And so I was digging up some dirt on that. And Joe Beasley got pretty mad at me, but eventually he wound up in jail. So, I mean, that's an example of the kind of thing that might have made it into the column. I don't know. Should have warned me out that you were going to ask me that, because I probably still have some of those old papers, and I could have dug them up and see what I was writing about in those days. But it was mostly local politics kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm. And was it...
So I became... So this was part of being sort of the movement doctor, one of the movement doctors in New Orleans, the movement covering civil rights and anti-war and maybe other issues along the way. So one of the things I did was I got a book called 4F, and it told you all the different conditions that could make you 4F, 4F being ineligible on health grounds for like bone spurs are an example. Donald Trump could share that with you. He had bone spurs and therefore was not eligible to be in the military. But there are a whole lot of other reasons. And so part of what I did was to examine people who would be draft eligible and find one of those reasons, write them a letter that would get them out of the draft. This was all legal. Whoever's looking at this, this was all legal.
Yeah.
I know the nurses called me the hippie doctor. And maybe it was just because I was wearing bell bottoms, I'm not sure. And sandals. What was the question?
Just some of the things that you were writing in the paper.
Oh, writing in the paper, yeah, I can't remember, because it was local stuff that was, you know, important at the time, or seemed important at the time.
Did your medical colleagues know that you were engaged in these activities, that you were chairing this, the medical human rights, and that you were writing in the paper under the pseudonym?
Did I have a pseudonym? I think I might have had my name in the byline.
Oh, it did? Okay.
I think so, yeah. No, I wasn't trying to keep it secret.
Yeah.
Yeah, and nobody seemed to be upset about it. So, we organized one of the MC, Medical Committee for Human Rights, the things we did, we organized some of the charity hospital patients who demanded to be advisory committee to the director of the hospital, and he acquiesced and made them the advisory committee, and they shared their complaints with him. I mean, he was actually a fairly liberal guy for the time and place. It wasn't a secret, even though we called it underground. Papers were underground papers, but they were being sold on the street, so none of it was secret.
And your colleagues either just didn't take notice or were supportive?
They took notice, they didn't care.
Yeah.
We were friends, you know, they were not... They were not extremists. Some of them were racist, but...
Do you recall how you came to write for the papers? Did you go visit and introduce yourself, or?
That's probably what I did, but I can't really remember. Mm-hmm. I probably just walked into the office and said, "Hi, I'm your local doc. I've had some experience writing in newspapers, and maybe I could write in yours." And they were always, they didn't pay you anything, so. They were happy to have somebody making contributions. It was a little less than they had to do, as long as it fit what the paper was trying to achieve.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess that was my first experience with underground papers, which the New Orleans version of what the Great Speckled Bird was here.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say the bird was probably halfway in between the ungarbled word and the NOLA Express, in the sense of the, you know, entertainment-oriented psychedelic paper and the more political paper.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that you were, well, do you recall how frequently these papers were published? Were they weeklies or more monthly?
It was more than monthly. It was either weekly or every 2 weeks.
Okay.
Sure.
And do you think that you were submitting columns every issue, or?
I probably did one every 2 weeks.
Okay.
That sounds about right.
Yeah.
See, again, I could rummage through the musty archives and find some of these old papers, I think, and then I would know what I wrote about and how often and everything.
Right.
Whether it had my byline or not, I've forgotten a lot of that.
So you were there for 2 years, and then you come to Atlanta.
And then I came to Atlanta, right. The war was still going on.
Yes. And remind me, had you already been accepted into the Public Health Service?
Right.
And you just had to fulfill your residency?
So I was accepted into the Public Health Service during my year in Vista.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a program, and I don't remember what it was called. There was something called the Berry Plan for people who were going, physicians who were going into the military, where you got a deferment to finish your residency and then you went into the military. This was the equivalent thing in the Public Health Service. It had a different name, but you were allowed to finish your residency, and then you went into the Public Health Service. And so that's what I had been admitted to. That's what kept me out of the Army and allowed me to finish my year in Vista, do my 2 years of residency, and then come to Atlanta in the Public Health Service.
And so you moved to Atlanta, and if I recall correctly from reviewing your CV, that's in 1972.
Yes.
Had you been to Atlanta previously?
Well, I will say that when my dad was in the Army, remember that? Yeah. He was stationed for a time at, it was called the Lawson Army Medical Center, which was located in Chambly.
Okay.
And so I was living in Chambly when I was 2 years old. Other than that, I don't think I had ever been to Atlanta. So I had come here, so in the Epidemic Intelligence Service that I was becoming a part of, you start in July, which is July 1st is the turnover time for all things medical. It's when you start your internship or residency. When you start in the EIS, so you come to Atlanta in April for the annual EIS conference. And at that time, you interview with different programs. So there are, for instance, there's influenza, there's what they call special pathogens, sort of unusual pathogens, there's hospital infections, there's immunization, there's family planning, so there's all these different programs. And there's also state programs, so about half the core works at CDC in Atlanta, and the other half is assigned to various state health departments around the country. And then the incoming EIS officers interview the programs, and then there's a kind of a match that takes place that's like the match for residency programs. So you do a list of the programs that EIS officers are interested in, and the programs do a list of the people they've interviewed that they would like to have as part of their program, and then there's some kind of a computer algorithm that makes the match. And I wound up in the nutrition program, which is here in Atlanta. So that's actually a long answer to your question about whether I'd been to Atlanta before. Yeah, I was in Atlanta in April for that process, and then came back in July to begin my 2 years of service, which became three because at the end of 2 years, I didn't know what to do next, so I stayed for another year. Some people in my EIS class made their whole career at CDC. That just sort of never occurred to me. I came here to do my 2 years of military equivalent time and then stayed for a third year because I couldn't think of what to do next, but I don't think I ever had a thought about spending the rest of my career at CDC.
Mm.
Some guys did, some men and some women. I should mention, if anybody who's looking at this and wondering, Epidemic Intelligence Service sounds sort of weird. So this was a program that was created in the 1950s, actually. The EIS is a corps of field epidemiologists who typically go out on outbreaks. So if you read in the paper that there are a bunch of people who are getting sick from something, it's a couple of EIS officers who will go out to investigate and find out what it is that's making them sick. Or if you hear about Zika virus in Latin America, or if you hear about Legionnaire's disease in Minneapolis, or if you read about it, you know, so this is the kind of investigations that they do. And this is, I think, quite important work. And when they were trying to get it funded in the 1950s, during the height of the Cold War, the Congress wasn't interested in funding anything that wasn't involved in national defense. So by calling it the Epidemic Intelligence Service, they were able to get funding for it. That's what it's still called, or EIS for short. So I became an EIS officer. Things were quite...
In the nutrition program.
In the nutrition program. So you don't, in this country, have outbreaks of malnutrition. So we were... The big project of the nutrition program that had been going on before, and it was just wrapping up, really, when I came into the program, it's called the 10-State Nutrition Survey. So at the time, there had been a series of scandals about hunger in America. And George McGovern actually was running a congressional investigation, and there had been TV specials and that sort of thing. And the word was out that there were people in the United States, the richest country in the world, there were people who did not have enough to eat. And so CDC was called upon to do an investigation of this, and the investigation consisted of a big nutrition survey. Couldn't do the whole country, it's too big. They did 10 states. I can't remember how the 10 states were selected. They did 10 states and identified that there was a lot of undernutrition, kids that were underweight, kids that were vitamin deficient. And this was published in a big series of volumes and became very unpopular with the Nixon administration, who didn't want to hear about hunger in America and expand the food stamp program and expand the other program to feed people, you know, go away. So we did go away. They disbanded the nutrition program. I mentioned earlier I was interested in tropical diseases. Mm-hmm. And intestinal parasites, and so when the nutrition program dissolved, I moved over to the parasitic diseases branch and did some work there. So then I spent 2 years in the parasitic diseases. And that was starting to run out of voice.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember what the question was, but that was the answer.
And so, July 1972, you and your wife moved to Atlanta.
Right.
Where do you first settle when you get here?
Well, I lived in a rented ranch house on North Emery Place, which is close to CDC on Clifton Road.
Mm-hmm.
just off of Briarcliff. It's right near the corner of Briarcliff and North Decatur Road.
Okay. And what were your impressions of Atlanta when you got here? What was the city like?
Well, the city was considerably less well-developed than it is now. The Hyatt Regency Hotel was the tallest building downtown. It was considered like the eighth wonder of the world. It was the first building that was built with a big open atrium that is almost standard in hotels these days, but John Portman designed this hotel and became famous for doing it. And the front door of the Hyatt Regency Hotel was known as the Jesus Christ door because people would come in and look up and say, Jesus Christ. It was a popular entertainment at the time to ride the glass elevators up and down.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see that these days nobody would be amazed at an open atrium in a hotel and would not be so entertained by riding up and down an elevator. So it was relatively primitive. But compared to today, the restaurant scene today is just incredible compared to what it was then. The entertainment possibilities are far advanced beyond what they were then. Population hadn't actually changed that much. I mean, Atlanta has been 400,000, 500,000, was back then as well. The urban sprawl has gotten worse, bigger, depending on how you look at it. So the metro area continues to grow, and I guess that feeds a lot of the restaurants and the entertainment and so forth, and the hotels and the business center. A lot of businesses have moved here, and so we got a lot of big buildings downtown. So the city has changed a great deal since we moved here in 1972. So we lived for a year in that little rented house, and then we lived for 2 years in another rented house in Morningside. And then I indicated earlier that I was having some trouble deciding what to do post-CDC, mm-hmm. and my wife had one set of places she wanted to go, and I had a different set of places I wanted to go, so we compromised and stayed here. And I took a job at Emory as the medical director of a new neighborhood health center that was affiliated with Grady Hospital. But having decided to stay, I guess, we finally bought a house in Lake Claire. Although we could say it was in Candler Park, because it's on Clifton Road,
mm-hmm.
right about at the corner of Clifton Road and McClendon,
mm-hmm.
if you know where that is.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where that's where we were living. All right, so I took this job at Emory. Grady Hospital was and is the big public hospital downtown. Provides health care for people who don't have other access to health care, particularly if they live in Fulton or DeKalb County. But everybody had to come to Grady Hospital downtown. And Fulton and DeKalb County are quite large, so it would be helpful to the patient population. It would be more efficient for the hospital if there were alternatives. And in fact, Grady had secured a team of consultants from the American Public Health Association who came to Atlanta and said you ought to open some satellite clinics. And so that's what they called them, satellite clinics at the time. Now they're called neighborhood health centers. But they opened the first one in DeKalb County. And my friend and colleague Henry Kahn, who was also an EIS officer, who also worked on the Bird, became the medical coordinator for the new community neighborhood satellite clinic in DeKalb County. And I think he was the one who suggested to me that I might want to take a similar job. because they're opening another satellite clinic in East Point. So that's what I did. So I took this job with Emory University as the medical coordinator for the new W.T. Brooks Clinic. It was called W.T. Brooks, was a local civil rights activist who had died a few years previously. They named the clinic after him. Mm-hmm. So I worked there for 5 years. And at that point, there was this new medical school opening across town, Morehouse School of Medicine, that was focused on healthcare for the underserved, services to underserved communities, minority health, primary care, and graduating more African-American physicians. And this was just the sort of thing that I was supportive of, interested in. And one day a delegation from Morehouse came to visit us. And Morehouse at that time was providing, had just opened actually, they had their first class, so this was 1975. Is that right? No, this was 79. So it was 1979, they had their first class. First class, and the curriculum called for a course in community health in the second year. And Emory was actually doing a lot of teaching for Morehouse at that point. So they came over to see us in the Department of Community Medicine at Emory and said, would you be willing to teach a course in community health for our second year medical students? And we said we'd think about that. And so after they were gone, I said to my chair, Tom Sellers, if we're going to do this, I'd really like to be part of it, because this sounds like something I would like to do. So I don't remember the details of how this went down, but I do know that before any of that happened, Morehouse hired a new chair of the department of what then became called Community and Family Medicine. And that was David Satcher. Some people looking at this may recognize that name. He eventually became director of CDC, and after that was Surgeon General. Mm-hmm. But at this point, he was recruited from California to be the founding chair of the Department of Community and Family Medicine, and I went over and interviewed with him. And we entered into an arrangement under which I worked half-time for Morehouse and half-time for Emory for a year. And at the end of that year, I said to David, if you've got a full-time spot, I'd like to apply for it. And he hired me full-time, and I left Emory. And the year after that, or maybe it was 2 years after that, David was invited to become the president of Meharry Medical College in Nashville. And so I sort of inherited his job. And a year or two after that, we really sort of, at my request, split the Department of Community and Family Medicine into a separate Department of Family Medicine and a Department of Community Health and Preventive Medicine. I wanted to do that because of the combined Department of Community and Family Medicine. Family medicine is by far the dominant piece of that. It's the part that generates income by providing patient care, requires a lot more attention, eats up a much bigger part of the budget. And I really wanted to develop the community medicine part of it. So by splitting it and separate Department of Community Health and Preventive Medicine, I was able to do that. Somebody else had to take care of family medicine. And I spent the next 30 years doing that. So that brings us up to the present, and now we can quit.
And describe for us lay people what the distinction is between family and community. Like, what are the concerns or focus?
Well, so family medicine is, at one time it was called general practice.
Okay.
But general practice, you know, it was what I was doing in Lee County, actually, with a one-year rotating internship, and then I went out and practiced. And that's the minimum in many states that is required to get a license to practice. But family medicine is a three-year residency, like general internal medicine or general pediatrics, and a family physician provides services to all age groups from, I mean, some family physicians deliver babies. I think most don't these days, but that is a part of family medicine training. But they provide services to children and to adults and to the elderly in a clinical setting. Community health and preventive medicine is sort of whatever you want it to be. That's the great thing about it. But it is public health as provided by the public health department, which is everything from epidemic control, like EIS officers do, but at the local level, to, you know, keeping data, to providing health education, to providing basic clinical services like family planning and blood pressure control, health promotion programs, and it can include clinical medicine. And in our department, we were still providing clinical services through some of these neighborhood health centers and other places. It can include occupational health. Preventive medicine can be clinical preventive services. I mean, there are some physicians who practice preventive medicine just by doing lifestyle modification and screening. You know, just say, we only do prevention, we don't do treatment of illness. It's hard to make a living that way, but there are a few people who do it. So it's this whole range of things, and a lot of it falls back to the community organizing that I was doing in Lee County, and that's why I, you know, wanted to do this. So, we have a prevention research center that is funded by CDC. It's the Morehouse School of Medicine Prevention Research Center. It does community-based prevention research. Research on better ways to get people to not get infected with sexually transmitted diseases, finding better ways to get people screened for cancer, finding better ways to persuade adults to get the immunizations they ought to have, finding ways to get people to eat better diets and engage in more physical activity. And universities have been doing community-based research for years and years. And typically they exploit communities to do this. Researchers will come into the community, do surveys, take samples, go back to their offices, write papers, get grants, get promoted, and the community gets no benefit from that. So we've now come to subscribe to the view, we being the, I think, university community in general, subscribe to the point of view that this isn't really ethical, that the community needs to be a partner in doing this research, needs to benefit from the research, and needs to have the leading voice in how the research is done. Even though this is a principle that's subscribed to in theory many places, it's often not practiced very well. So we created at Morehouse a community coalition board that is the policy-making board for the Prevention Research Center, and is a coalition of really three academic institutions. Morehouse is in the lead, but there's a unit at Emory that's part of it, and Georgia State University. And then there are agency representatives on the board, the local health department, state health department, the public schools, the housing authority, Southside Health Center, big community health center, and the Atlanta Area Health Education Center, and I won't explain what that is because that's a whole other story. But these are agency people who provide important services, but generally they don't live in the community. The community with which we partner was originally Neighborhood Planning Unit Y in Southeast Atlanta. All of Atlanta is divided into neighborhood planning units. It's expanded now, so it's Neighborhood Planning Unit Y, X, V, Z, and T. But at that time it was one. Originally, this is 1998, I think. Neighborhood Planning Unit Y, and there are neighborhoods, I think 12 or 14 in MPUY, and each has its own community organization, so each community organization appointed a representative to the board. So the board is a coalition of academic entities, agencies, and neighborhood people. Neighborhood people, according to the bylaws, are always in the majority, and the chair of the board is always a neighborhood person. So if there were ever to be an issue in which the professionals were pitted against the neighborhood people would have the majority vote. That's never happened. I certainly hope it never happens, but the neighborhood people regard that majority interest in the board as being quite important. Mm-hmm. So we cite this as a model of how what is now called community-based participatory research should be conducted. And this all started as the answer to your question about what's the difference between family medicine mm-hmm. and community medicine or community health. So that gives you a sort of an idea about it. But I will add that back in the 60s and 70s, in the Lee County days, we were talking about community control. That morphed in the 90s and 2000s into community partnerships. So we've gone from community control, which is just community, i.e. Lee County Cooperative Clinic Board of Directors, community partnerships, i.e. Prevention Research Center, Community Coalition Board. Now we talk about community engagement. This troubles me because we keep seeming to backslide, and you can be engaged in a community with a community without the community having any real input into what's going on. You can go out, you know, do a health fair in the community and say we're engaged with the community, and that's some form of community engagement, but it's a long way from community control or even community partnership. Next question.
To go back and feel out that early period and when you were just getting in Atlanta and then ultimately working with the Bird, you described a bit of the sort of physical landscape of Atlanta and the size, geography. How might you describe the sort of social and cultural mood, for lack of a better way to capture it, of the feeling of Atlanta and the energy?
Well, Atlanta at the time that I moved here in the early 70s was a part of the 70s, really. I mean, Peachtree Street was where the hippies hung out. There was a free clinic on Peachtree Place. Can't remember what it was called. I worked there occasionally. Underground Atlanta was thriving. There were restaurants and bars and people down there having a good time. So at least from my perspective, it was a good place to be. The people who thought otherwise. We're living in the suburbs, perhaps that's why we've got so much urban sprawl. They didn't want to live in the same town with the hippies and the underground people. And, but it was a comfortable place for me and my friends.
Mm-hmm. And during this period of the mid to late 60s, 70s, is there music or film or books or anything that are helping shape your worldview?
What was I reading in the 1970s?
Exactly.
So let me think about books that helped shape my worldview. Over the years, I'm going to go way back.
Yeah.
Hiroshima by John Hershey, which describes what happened when we dropped atomic bombs on Japan. Another Country by James Baldwin. The Autobiography of Malcolm X. Let's come back to that later.
Okay.
I'm trying to remember what I was reading back then.
And if you think of it later tonight or in subsequent days, if that germ has been planted in your head, you can send us an email and we can add it to the to make sure that's captured. As you're becoming involved in a lot of these community organizations, initiatives, and you are a medical doctor, how was your family responding to this? Particularly, like, your father came out of the medical field. Was he?
My parents were absolutely supportive. I'll mention that when during this year in Lee County and in the subsequent years, myself and my successors would send our laboratory work to my dad's lab in St. Louis, and he'd do the lab work for free. Both of my parents were as anti-war as I was. My brother was a draft resister, who was drafted and refused to take the step forward, and so didn't enter the military, and I think moved his site of induction to Boston, where he went and lived for a time with my in-laws, who lived in Boston, because the judge there was supposed to be the most lenient of all the judges who might rule case. And I don't remember the details, but he was never arrested or dragged away, and I think eventually years later he got a letter that said you can quit worrying about it. And my wife, of course, was totally supportive.
And on the topic of your wife, what was she doing once you all settled in Atlanta?
So when we were in New Orleans, she was working in a child development center, a research center, in New Orleans, and she continued to work there. I mean, she did most of what she did at home here in Atlanta, and flew down to New Orleans fairly often and did some work there, but. She continued doing that. That actually became the basis for her PhD dissertation. Remember, I met her when she was a graduate student. It took her 17 years to get her PhD, but she finally did.
I sympathize with her in a very personal way. That's inspiring.
I think current University of Chicago students wouldn't be allowed to do that. I think there's a cutoff that is somewhat less than 17 years.
Yeah, probably so. You mentioned the free clinic on Peachtree Place. Do you recall how that was operated? The sort of governing structure of it, or were you involved at all?
I was not really involved with that. And I said I worked there. I'm not sure that I did, but we had started, several of us who worked at CDC, physicians who were working at CDC, started a free clinic in Decatur. And I know I was seeing patients over there. Mm-hmm. That free clinic eventually became the Oakhurst Community Health Center, which mm-hmm. is still functions mm-hmm. these days. But that was a different clientele. That was low-income people who lived in Decatur and elsewhere in DeKalb County, whereas the clinic on Peachtree Place was mostly middle-class white kids who were living the hippie life.
Right.
In Atlanta.
I was curious because there's a dissertation on Atlanta's counterculture and New Left that has a section on some of the community organizations and partnerships with various religious organizations that created some community centers and a health clinic.
Okay, there was a guy named Dennis Doherty, I think was his name.
Yeah.
Is he on your interview list?
I don't think that he is on our...
My recollection is that he was the individual who sort of ran that clinic. I think it was Doherty. Now, whether he was on the bird or not, I don't know.
And with the bird, did you encounter, were you aware of this paper before you moved to Atlanta, or...
I doubt it. I think I probably, but being a underground newspaper journalist when I moved here, I see somebody on the street selling the great speckled bird. I said, well, I'll find out about that. And I suppose that's the way it went. I don't know. I mentioned Henry Kahn earlier. Mm-hmm. So he, this is my whole involvement with the bird. He and I split a column. It was called The Great Spockled Doc. I think that was Henry who came up with that name, Spock, referring to Ben Spock, who was the anti-war pediatrician that mm-hmm. we all admired. And it was a health column. People were supposed to send in their health questions, and we would write an answer. Mm-hmm. And he was known as Dr. Sawyer Legoff, and I was known as Dr. Feelgood, I think. And most of the time we had to write our own questions because nobody was sending them in. But that's what we did. It was not political, it was about health issues.
Mm-hmm. Do you know, was it Henry, and you knew him through the health service?
We were both in the same EIS class.
Okay. Right?
That's where I met him.
Yeah. And did you guys come up with this idea together, or did he approach you? And
I don't remember. I don't know.
Had you...
Are you interviewing him?
Yes, we will be.
Okay, well, maybe he can answer that question.
Yeah. I have interviewed his wife.
Oh, okay.
Mickey.
Yeah.
So, but you're the first of the pair that wrote this column.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you recall whether you had actually gone down to the Bird offices and had a conversation with anybody, or?
So I'm going to say that it's probably Henry that negotiated most of this.
Mm-hmm.
And that was sort through my failing memory about stuff like this. I think that he's probably the guy who set this up. I visited the offices once or twice, but certainly didn't hang out there. Didn't know most of the people who worked there. I knew some of them. But not by going down to the office, because it was rarely there.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe Henry was there more. I don't know.
Do you know how you would submit your articles?
Well, I couldn't email them in because email hadn't been invented yet.
Possible you mailed them in.
It could be that I stuck them in an envelope and sent them through the postal mail.
Mm-hmm. But you didn't attend like the cooperative meetings and all of that. Did you read the paper weekly though?
Yeah. Like I read other papers, I read some of it.
Mm-hmm. And is there any particular issue or topic that the Bird was covering that's most memorable to you, or?
Well, no.
No. What about things that you wrote in the paper, the column that you wrote?
Well, as I say, we had to think up our own questions.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember writing one about head lice, which actually is a common thing I get asked about anyway, so I wrote a question about that, and I wrote an answer about that. Probably something about nutrition.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're coming back after a little break. When we stopped, you were talking about some of the articles the topics of some of the columns. You said
so
probably somewhere.
Common infection, nutrition problems, the ordinary things that people might have questions about regarding their health. As a public service, it was rather modest because, as I say, it was rare that somebody would actually mail in a question. Mm-hmm. They must have had other sources of health information other than the columnists with rather odd-sounding names in the Speckled Bird.
Do you recall writing, because I've looked through the Bird several times, and my curiosity was piqued by the Great Speckled Doc column, and I think I recall correctly that there were some columns on drug use, psychedelics, there was one I think specifically on the effects of marijuana use. There were some columns maybe about pregnancy and childbirth. Do you recall penning any of those, or?
I don't, but I might have.
Yeah.
Probably not the ones about childbirth. Very likely the ones about marijuana, but I don't remember.
Mm-hmm. On that point of that you probably didn't write on childbirth, can you speak of your recollection and perception at this time where you're talking about community control, and really active involvement in health issues. And at this time, this period of history, you have the emergence of like the feminist women's health centers and women trying to reclaim control over their bodies, the famous book Our Bodies Ourselves, and doing self-gynecology. What you recall of these sort of conversations and where you fell in that sort of debate of how much is the medical authority really the proper authority or expert, and how much should be patient-driven?
So this was not something I took an active role in. Mm-hmm. I would say that I was supportive of that perspective, but I think I viewed it as largely a women's movement. Mm-hmm. So if asked to participate, if asked to do something, I was happy to participate, but it was not anything that I could, in my view, not something I could legitimately aspire to a leadership role in, because it was really a women's movement. So I tried to be supportive as I could, but it was not at the top of my agenda.
What about the analog, and I'm not, yeah, the analog of that, but sort of in the, just the more natural living, health food movement, alternative medicine. It seemed that in the 70s this was really coming into prevalence in countercultures and even bleeding over into mainstream.
Well, and that continues to be the case, mm-hmm. I would say. And there's a lot, particularly in the area of nutrition, there's a lot going on in the area of what's sometimes called alternative medicine that is still very prominent today. And, mm-hmm. and there's a huge amount of money spent on and visits to practitioners of things like naturopathy or Reiki therapy or healing touch. So I have to admit, when it comes to healthcare, I'm pretty much a mainstream medicine kind of guy. I think that there's a lot of confusion around nutrition that is not helped by the fact that at least the perception is there's some new recommendation every couple of weeks about what you ought to be, you know, should you have more fish oil or not, or how about a lot of vitamin D or not a lot of vitamin D, and so the jury is still out on a lot of these things, but I think ultimately it's the jury that needs to have the say. I mean, we need to have some scientific evidence for the stuff that we promote, and I think there is no scientific evidence for a lot that goes on in the area of alternative medicine. We now have a National Institute of Complementary and Alternative Medicine, NCAM, something like that. So one of the NIH institutes, big federally funded research enterprise that does clinical trials with various alternative medicine modalities. And some things that are originally viewed as crackpot turn out to be valid. Acupuncture is an example. And there are other things that are viewed as crackpot that turn out to be crackpot, but they don't go away anyway. Mm-hmm. But I tend to go with the evidence. I understand why people steer away from traditional medicine, mainstream medicine, because there's so much that seems to go wrong, so much in just daily practice that seems to be headed off in the wrong direction. Here's a story to illustrate that point. I have a friend in St. Louis, an old high school friend in St. Louis, that I see perhaps once a year when I go back to visit. So my visit last year was postponed. We had agreed to meet for lunch on a particular date, but he emailed me to say that he had to go down to Branson, Missouri, where a lot of people retired in Branson, Missouri. Mm-hmm. His mother-in-law was there, and she was on death's doorstep. She didn't seem to have long to live, and so they were going to bring her back to St. Louis and put her in hospice, which they did. So we had to, but we kept up with him by email to see how she was doing. So and she had lost weight. She wasn't eating. She looked like she really reached the end of the line. So in hospice, they asked her if she'd like to stop taking the 20-some-odd pills she was taking every day. Because, you know, if you're going to die anyway, what's the point of taking this medicine? So she said yes, and she stopped taking the pills. And then she regained her appetite. She started eating, gaining weight, and feeling better, and going out with her daughter and son-in-law. And now she's back in Branson, Missouri, and living happily. So here's somebody who was almost killed by regular old medical care, medicine to control her high blood pressure and her high blood sugar or whatever chronic infirmities of old age she might have had. So I think it's that kind of experience that makes people veer away from people with MDs after their name, and they say, well, let's go see the naturopath. Because mm-hmm. they're just doing natural stuff.
Right. And what were you doing in Atlanta in the 1970s, this period, while you were working on The Bird, for fun and entertainment?
Well, I'd listen to music. There was a place called the Southern Music Emporium or something like that, that was located in what is now the Lindbergh Shopping Center, so at least that area, mm-hmm. the Lindbergh Marta stop. I remember seeing Jerry Lee Lewis there. He's one of my favorite rock musicians. I remember going to the opera at the Civic Center. The Metropolitan Opera Touring Company would come around. Not a very good place to listen to opera.
Mm-hmm.
Go to the symphony. Go to the movies. Go to a restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
Go ride the elevators at the Hyatt Regency. So nothing very exciting.
Yeah, but got out and about. Did you have a close network of friends that you developed in Atlanta that you socialized with regularly?
Yeah, we have friends that we socialize with. Some that we still do, others have moved away. Mm-hmm. Let's do this. Other meaningful experiences in my life. Let me mention the smallpox program. So the World Health Organization in the late 60s, I guess, determined that it would be possible, thought that it would be possible to eradicate smallpox, to totally get rid of the disease. They thought this because smallpox had disappeared entirely from the Western Hemisphere, even though some of the countries in the Western Hemisphere don't have sophisticated healthcare systems. But just with the sort of routine activities that they were doing, they'd enabled the country countries to become free of smallpox. I wish I'd brought some photos of smallpox along. It is truly an awful disease that covers the body of the patient with pustules. And if they get in the patient's eyes, they are blinded. And 25% of the people with the disease died, and there's no treatment. There still is no treatment for smallpox. So when I was at CDC, the word went around that they're looking for volunteers to go to India and participate in the smallpox eradication program. So I raised my hand and said I'd be interested in doing that. And so I became, for 3 months, a special epidemiologist for the World Health Organization. The strategy had become, rather than trying to vaccinate everybody, to engage in what was called search and containment, and later became known as ring vaccination. So there would be a search every month. There would be searchers. The program mobilized all the health workers in smallpox endemic areas. Very controversial program because it meant they were pulling people away from malaria control, pulling people away from family planning, pulling people away from everything else to focus on smallpox eradication. The idea being, we get rid of smallpox, we'll be rid of it forever, you won't have to engage in vaccination, everybody will be able to go back to what they were doing, but for now we gotta, this is a rare opportunity and we've gotta jump on it. So every month there would be a search, every case of smallpox was hopefully to be identified. People around that case were to be vaccinated rather than trying to vaccinate everybody. And this proved to be successful in Nigeria. They're doing it in India. So people in this program who were assigned to India to participate in the program were responsible for kind of circuit riding around a district to the where the local health offices were, where the smallpox searches originated and where they kept records of every village in a chart on the wall where all the outbreaks were, how many people were vaccinated, and so forth. And my job and the job of people who were doing the same thing that I was doing was to circuit ride and just make sure that this was happening the way it was supposed to happen. So typically I would arrive at one of these offices and there would be the chart on the wall of all the outbreaks. And I'd say, I'd just pick one at random. I'd say, let's go visit that one. And the local health officer would say, you don't want to visit that one. It's way off the paved road. Here we are going down mud roads again. It's rainy season. You're going to get stuck in the mud. You don't want to go to that one. You want to go to this one, which is on the paved road. Mm-hmm. And so I'd say, well, now I know I want to go to the one that I pointed out first place. So that's what we do. And we'd get stuck in the mud. And so then we'd have to walk. And we got there. And when I got there, we found out that a lot of people hadn't been vaccinated. Which was probably the real reason the health officer didn't want to go there. So that was my job. One time, it was customary, probably is still customary, for wealthy people there in this rural area to have an elephant. I guess they go out joyriding on their elephant on Saturdays. I don't know. But we got stuck in the mud, and down the road was this big house. Figured the guy owned an elephant, so I said, let's go see if we can borrow the guy's elephant. So we walked over there. Everybody was really hospitable, and this guy said, come right in, and say, he made us tea, and we sat down, and we talked, and I said, can I borrow your elephant? And he said, sure. And so the elephant comes with a mahout, you know, an elephant guy. We got up on the elephant's back, and we'd ride along, and every now and then the mahout would smack the elephant in the head with something like a crowbar. I don't know why the elephant listened. I mean, the elephant could kill everybody without half trying, but this is the way they deal with the elephants. So we rode the elephant to the outbreak. Come back to that in people well. So when I first got to this, my district was Semastopol, and when I first got there and had an opportunity to ride around and get the lay of the land, there were so many villages with outbreaks and so many cases in every village, and it just seemed like smallpox was everywhere. And I said, this is ridiculous. I am on a fool's errand. This is never going to be eradicated. This is impossible. I'll just think of this as an interesting intercultural experience. And by the time I left, 3 months later, I couldn't find a case. I have to say, one of the most dramatic and rewarding experiences of my career. So I just wanted to mention that as something that affected me. And also, 3 or 4 years later, we were down to the last few cases in Somalia. And by this time, I was working at the W.T. Brooks Clinic, but there was sort of a call that went out for people to participate again. And I was qualified because I had the other smallpox experience. And so I knew what smallpox looked like, and I knew how to tell it from chickenpox and other things that you needed to know. And at that time, I had decided I had never been to Africa. I said, I want to go to Africa. And here's an opportunity to go to Africa. So I signed up, and I took a leave of absence for 5 months from my job at the W.T. Brooks Clinic. Somehow they managed to get along without me. I was hoping to be able to see the last case, but I got there too late. Last case had already happened. Last case was a guy named Ali Malin, who was a cook at a hospital in Merka in Somalia, where the next to the last case had come and had transmitted the disease to Ali, and so he became the last case, or the last naturally occurring case. When I arrived there and met the people at the office, smallpox office in Mogadishu, they said, oh, you're the guy who rode the elephant to the outbreak. So my little adventure with the elephant had made me famous in the smallpox world for a small amount of time. So I did the same kind of job, riding around to these various health offices and make sure the searches were taking place. Somebody found a case of something they thought might be smallpox, I would get called to go see it. It was chickenpox, or it was scabies, or it was something that wasn't smallpox. Somebody was doing a study on camelpox, so I was looking for it. So it turns out that I guess every mammal species has a pox virus that infects it, including camels. Disease called camelpox. Found a couple of camels that seemed to had something that might have been camelpox. So we scraped some stuff off the lesion and send it off. And I was doing other errands like that, but there wasn't any more smallpox. But it was a very interesting episode. Anyway, Somalia was fighting this low-scale war with Ethiopia at the time for control of the Ogaden Desert. I'm not sure why anybody would want to control the Ogaden Desert, but that's what people do. So I was in a very actually remote area of Somalia, where Kenya, Ethiopia, and Somalia all come together. And we'd be riding down the road, and there'd be some military there that said, you have to stop because there are some landmines in the road ahead. We've got to get those cleared. So we'd camp out by the side of the road. Next morning they'd say, okay, you can go ahead now. So we went ahead with full confidence that the Somali army had cleared off any landmines that there might have been out there. I mean, some of this stuff in retrospect seems sort of crazy. Anyway, there was no more smallpox to be found, but it was certainly an interesting few months spent there. So that's the smallpox thing.
When you were in New Orleans for your residency, you chaired the
Medical Committee for Human Rights.
Yes. Was there a similar organization or the same organization here in Atlanta when you came here?
I'm going to have to say, I guess not, because I don't remember any interaction with any such organization. So the Medical Committee for Human Rights did sort of go away after a while, and I guess that was about when it went away.
Did anything similar develop that you became involved in? I know that when the HIV/AIDS epidemic became such an epidemic that there were medical committees put together that were advocacy oriented.
I wasn't involved in that movement. I mean, there was certainly anti-war activity that was going on in Atlanta when I came here. As federal employees, we had to be sort of restrained in our involvement with the movement. Mm. I don't remember any NCA, any Medical Committee for Human Rights activity, mm-hmm. and the AIDS epidemic. That was later, so that was in the late 80s, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
And I was not involved in the AIDS-related movement, the ACT UP group. I was not part of that.
How did the AIDS epidemic impact your work, if at all?
I was more of an observer than somebody who was really directly involved. Was not caring for patients with AIDS. Patients I was caring for were little kids who, certainly at that time, some were contracting AIDS because of maternal with child transmission. There were people who were expert in doing that, and initially there really wasn't any treatment, it was just supportive. Mm-hmm. And then later it became a real specialized area because you had to be familiar with the various drug cocktails and so on. But I can't say that I was involved in a meaningful way. It was more just reading about it, talking to people about it.
Was it at all an issue that ever came up in the community partnerships or community involvement?
It was an issue that came up because people were just afraid at that time. And for a long time people didn't know where it came from, how did you get it. And then when people did know, then there was all the stigma that was associated with it. And so there are reassurances to be made and myths to be debunked and all of that. But I was not part of any organized piece of that. There was the kind of fear and community concern and myth to be debunked. It's something I got more involved in after the bioterror attacks in 2001, mm-hmm. I guess, right after 9/11. Mm-hmm. There was this episode where somebody mailed around some anthrax spores, yeah. And a number of people got sick and a few died. And then the George W. Bush administration seized on this as a sort of a fear campaign, and all of a sudden people were made to be afraid of bioterror and medical students were to be taught about the agents which might be used in biological attacks, which included tularemia and anthrax and botulism and smallpox. And so the Bush administration decided that there must be some smallpox virus out there in the hands of terrorists. And perhaps this was part of the weapons of mass destruction arsenal that Saddam Hussein had. And there was a campaign to vaccinate 500,000 first responders so that in case of a case of smallpox, that somebody who had been vaccinated could be called to tend to them or see about them. And in the public health community, I have to say that most of us, I think, recognize this as bunk. That people, that Al-Qaeda folks who were hiding in caves or in villages could not be carrying around smallpox virus that they would somehow keep from escaping and starting another outbreak of smallpox. But you know, for the, there is surviving smallpox virus currently in a freezer at CDC and one in Russia. And that's all the smallpox virus in the world. And the terrorists don't have it because the terrorists don't have the facilities to keep it under control. And if they had it, it would have gotten out of control and we'd know about it. And we knew that. But there was this huge fear campaign about smallpox. And they were going to vaccinate 500,000 people. The campaign flopped. And the reason it flopped was because some of the adults that they were vaccinating in the military especially, started having heart attacks. And it turned out that the vaccine had the potential at least to cause cardiac inflammation and cause heart attack. And we didn't know this because in the day, back in the days when we were vaccinating everybody, we were vaccinating one-year-olds. And adults were not usually vaccinated. Some were. I got vaccinated a bunch of times when I was working in India because people were afraid of vaccination, and so I demonstrate that it was harmless by getting vaccinated. I think I am really immune to smallpox, even though it's been a long time. So at that point, the program was discontinued, and I guess we decided that smallpox was not a threat after all. But because I was one of the few people around who had actually seen smallpox, knew about smallpox, knew how it was transmitted, it would have looked like, so I was on television and interviewed by radio stuff. I had another little burst of notoriety because of my familiarity with the smallpox. But people in the community were afraid. They're afraid to open envelopes, afraid to open, you know, they're afraid that there's bio stuff out there. And they were, I know that the chair of the community coalition board said, you could really do us a favor by printing up a fact sheet about anthrax that we could distribute to reassure people. Whether they would be at risk, what they can do to protect themselves from biological agents. And so we did that. So there was a lot of concern at that time. And then, you know, after a while it went away. Mm-hmm.
Are there any other highlights in your long career that you want to mention?
It wasn't an event in time, at a point in time. I'll just say that I feel good about my career at Morehouse, starting with Department of Community Health and Preventive Medicine that consisted of about four people after we divided them. And over the years working to start a residency program in public health and preventive medicine, a Master of Public Health program, the Prevention Research Center that I'm Health Promotion Resource Center, which is different. It doesn't do research, but focuses on health promotion, developing a community health class for medical students that is sort of groundbreaking because it moves the class out of the classroom and into the community, and there's a lot of medical schools now doing similar kinds of things, but this was maybe the first, at least one of the first. In the U.S., actually, it's fairly common. I learned about this in visiting some schools in Africa where they're already doing stuff like that. Morehouse is now known as a kind of a pioneer community-based school with a focus on the social mission of medical education. And you know, I feel like I had something to do with that, so I feel good about that.
And at this point in time, where we are in the world, what are some of the ideas, ideals, concerns that are most pronounced for you?
Well, there is war. People keep trying to tell me that Donald Trump is the worst president ever. I say, I'm not going to call him the worst president ever until he starts a war. We have had other presidents that have started wars, and so anybody that starts a war gets down to the bottom of the list, as far as I'm concerned, because that's, you just have to look at what's going on in Syria. Not that we started that one, but we've been involved in it and helped kept it going, to get an idea of what a disaster war is for everybody in the war zone. Maybe this is something I focused on because of thinking about Vietnam, where we were fighting for nothing. The result of the death of 50,000 Americans and probably a million Vietnamese, fighting for nothing. And in Syria, they're fighting for, I don't know, it's Al-Assad or ISIS. I don't know which is worse. But I've just been saying, somebody's got to win. Neither of them can be as bad as the war. The war in Iraq, which is total fabrication. Sure, Saddam Hussein was a bad guy. He wasn't nearly as bad as the war. So there is war. And then we happen to be at what might be a turning point in the gun debate in this country. And it's all because of the school shooting. So think about this. 17 kids were killed in this school shooting in Florida. And then students around the country walked out of class in a demonstration, stayed out of class for 17 minutes to represent each of the 17 people that were killed in that shooting. If instead students had decided to stay out of class for 1 minute for every person that is killed by gun violence in a year in this country, they'd stay out of class for 84 days. We need to do, gun violence, school shootings brings it to our attention. But there are about 30,000 people killed every year in the United States by gunfire. The majority actually are suicides, but there's 12,000, 13,000 or thereabouts that are killed in homicide. And there's so much that we could do about it, but we don't. And we may be at a turning point because I think a change in public attitude is the thing that is eventually going to drive this. Public attitude maybe changing. So that's a big one for me. As a preventive medicine guy, if you can prevent some proportion of those 30,000 deaths of predominantly young people, that's a big deal.
Yeah. I think I just heard on the radio this morning that the CDC's finally being authorized or allowed to do research into gun violence.
Yeah, you know,
the public health aspect.
Right. There never was actually a law passed that said they couldn't. There was a piece of legislation that sort of suggested that Congress would not view this favorably, and I think CDC directors ever since then have said we can't do research on gun violence because Congress will get even with us by reducing our budget. So now there's something that's going to be enacted in the law that says it's okay, you can do research on gun violence. So that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. Trump's going to cut their budget anyway. Needs money for the wall that Mexico's supposed to pay for. I think we're outside the limits of this interview now. Mm-hmm. Or not, I don't know.
So to wrap things up, a few last questions. Do you maintain much contact with your friends from the 1970s, people that you worked on the Berg with, Henry, others?
Well, I maintain much contact with Henry.
Mm-hmm.
Other people who worked on the board, I mean, you've mentioned some names, Tom and Stephanie Coffin, whom I haven't talked to in years. Sue Thrasher, whom I haven't talked to in more years.
Mm-hmm.
Bob Goodman. I see him every now and then.
Mm-hmm.
Just sort of run into him somewhere. But I would say that Henry's the only one with the Bird group with whom I have very much contact. So I thought you were going to ask me about the friends in Vista, and I do maintain contact with a few of them, and every now and then there's a Vista reunion, and we all go back to Arkansas and see each other occasionally.
Mm.
So, there you are.
And from the standpoint of now 50 years since 1968, but from roughly 50 years from this period.
It is 50 years, actually. I'm going back to my 50-year reunion of my medical school graduating class in a couple months.
Wow. But 50 years from 68 and 40-some years from the 70s, how do you look back on that period of time and the work that you were doing? How does it resonate with you? How does it, you?
So the summer project in Chicago and the free clinic that followed, the year in Vista, the experience with my draft board, all of these things had a very formative impact on my perspective for the rest of my life. My parents had an effect, I'm sure. And I remember a few years ago saying to my son, "You know, I like your values," and he said, "Well, of course you do. They're the same as your values." And so I feel like I'm passing it on, and that's so both my kids. I have a son and a daughter and a stepson, and I think they all have similar perspectives, and that's gratifying as well. I acquired a stepson when it was probably past the time when he built his own values, but he's still. I think like everybody, experiences early in your life shape things going forward.
Well, we've covered a lot of ground.
Indeed.
Is there anything else that you'd like to add before we wrap?
I'm glad I got a chance at the end here to mention my kids. My daughter teaches elementary school science in Brooklyn. My son is in the last phase of getting a master's degree in natural resources management. He's a real environmental guy. He's at San Francisco State University. And my stepson is an attorney who's working for Snapchat. So it's through him that I learn about things like Snapchat.
Right.
Otherwise, I'd have no clue. I've only got half a clue now, but otherwise I wouldn't have any. So, as I say, I'm glad I got to mention them because they have been an important part of my life. And my wife, Marjorie Spears, is a woman of great achievement who worked at CDC. We met on an airplane. She worked at CDC, where she was for a time in charge of their institutional review board, a committee that does ethics reviews on research, and then directed the accrediting agency for IRBs, AHR, Accreditation Association for Human Research Protection Programs, the accrediting agency for IRBs, very important.
Yeah.
And is now directing a foundation that it focuses on expanded access, sometimes called compassionate use of experimental drugs. People have sort of run out of options with approved drugs and want to get access to experimental drugs. This foundation works with that mechanism so that people can do that. So she does really important work, and I'm proud to be married to her.
Absolutely. And you all have been married how long?
About exactly 20 years.
Okay. Still living in Atlanta?
Yeah, I think we'll. I think they'll carry me out of here in a box.
Well, I thank you so much for coming in. And like I said earlier, if there's anything that you think of that we've jogged your memory on,
okay,
feel free to
splice it into this somehow.
Well, you could just type an email. Like, absolutely, if you'd like to come back in and talk some more, we welcome that. But if there's anything that you just wanted to add to the record, we can put it in a file, like an email or
okay,
a simple note.
Okay, good. Well, thank you for inviting me. It has been a pleasure.
No, thank you.